If you work on a digital product or service, accessibility is a term you might have heard of recently. The word itself can mean many different things to many different people, so before we dive in, it's important to have a shared understanding of the term. For starters, accessibility is a foundational part of the web. Tim Berners-Lee established this when he helped to invent the internet in the form that we are all familiar with today. The fundamental design principles behind the web are set up to make it work for all people, whatever their hardware, software, language, location, or ability is. And in honoring these principles, we help to remove barriers to communication, information, and interaction that many people face in the physical world. In the more immediate, accessibility is the practice of designing products, devices, services, and environments for disabled people. In the physical world, accessibility work may mean observing guidelines to ensure that the entry and exit points of your building can be accessed by a wheelchair user. In the digital space, we have similar guidelines. These guidelines are all shaped by four core principles. Use them as a guide to help determine if what you are making is accessible or not. The first principle is perceivable. As you might have guessed, this principle covers anything related to a person's ability to see the world around them. Since the majority of the population is sighted, it's often something we take for granted. The principle of perceivable deals with the considerations around the quality of someone's sight, and it's important to make sure that your content can be easily seen, even in less than optimal situations. This includes low vision conditions such as cataracts or nearsightedness, harsh glare, or even the poor color quality of a projector. A good way to guarantee that something can be seen, and therefore be read and interacted with, is to use larger fonts and color values that have a high degree of contrast when placed on top of or next to each other. The second principle is operable. It covers making sure that the input a person is using to interact with technology is honored. Even though mice and trackpads are very commonplace, there are people who do not possess the physical dexterity required to use them. To make something operable, it needs to be capable of being interacted with using other forms of input, such as a keyboard or other specialized assistive technology devices. In doing so, you guarantee that anyone, regardless of their current device or ability, are able to navigate and take action on your content. The third of the four principles is understandable. Being able to figure out how to use something is incredibly important, especially when it comes to conversion and adoption. While you might be able to see an interface and use input other than a mouse to use it, there isn't a lot of incentive to return if you can't figure out what a product does or why it exists. An example of making something understandable would be using clear, concise, and direct messaging when providing form validation feedback. You want to ensure that error messages outline the issue, what can be done to fix it in a way that is free of technical jargon or highly abstract concepts. The final principle is robust. This principle helps to guarantee functionality across current and future technologies. Think about all the different devices that you have that can access the web, and how you can view a web page made in 2001 without any extra work or specialized software extensions. The reason older content just works on your browser is the same reason it will most likely just work for new technologies, so long as you're building it using web standards. We've begun to see the emergence of new form factors and input methods becoming commonplace consumer products. Things like car UI, voice assistants, and augmented reality. When you think about your site with a robust mindset, your content can adapt to these new technologies with far less effort and cost. The perceivable, operable, understandable, and robust principles are collectively referred to as PORE, and they are used to shape the web content accessibility guidelines, sometimes referred to as the WCAG. These guidelines are a set of rules outlining what constitutes an inaccessible experience, why it is inaccessible, and what can be done about it. The WCAG isn't a document that is just floating out there online without any real larger context. It is a comprehensive set of standards maintained by the World Wide Web Consortium as a method to guide the development of the web platform. It is also not new either. The WCAG has been around for 24 years and is updated to keep pace with the current state of technology. In fact, the WCAG is also an ISO standard. If you are unfamiliar, ISO standards are internationally recognized documents used to ensure the quality of materials, products, processes, and services. As I mentioned earlier, the Web Content Accessibility Guidelines helps us to determine what is not accessible. And this is an incredibly important thing to pay attention to because the WCAG can and has been used to help construct legal cases dealing with a failure to provide access. Which brings us to our next definition of accessibility. Accessibility is a legal concern. Much like protections established to prevent discrimination based on things like race, religion, gender, or political affiliation, accessibility guarantees a person's right to live in the world. This right is guaranteed by the Americans with Disabilities Act, a civil rights law passed by President George H.W. Bush in 1990. While we commonly think of legal accessibility concerns from a physical perspective, the federal government requires all of its digital technology to be accessible. This includes apps, external-facing websites, and internal-facing intranets, as well as any new privately owned product or service the government wishes to purchase. We are also beginning to see private companies being sued for discrimination because their digital products and services are built in such a way that they are unable to be used by disabled people. A few high-profile court cases established legal precedent when it was ruled that the digital space is an extension of the physical, and therefore the Americans with Disabilities Act was applicable. The thing I'd like to point out here is this is something we've never experienced before. Digital technology has never been as integrated into our lives as it is now, and the lines are only going to blur more and more as time goes on. The services that help us live our everyday lives continue to move online, and it's important to understand this with how it relates to access. This brings us to another definition of what accessibility is. Accessibility is a great way to think about product design. We deliberately construct our physical environments, and we also deliberately build our digital ones. By accommodating all the different ways people interact with technology when we build digitally, we are able to help ensure that the widest possible population can use your product or service. Another way to think about disability is it being a mismatch between an individual and their environment. What is perceived as detrimental in one context may be successful in another. Culture turns human traits into disabilities. So how do we go about creating an inclusive design? For starters, we can reference the inclusive design principles, which are 7 principles that big picture address the needs of people with permanent, temporary, and or situational disability. And if what you're designing doesn't observe these principles, chances are it's actually breaking one or more web content accessibility guideline rules as well. The first principle is to provide a comparable experience. This allows all people to be able to accomplish tasks in a way that suits them without undermining the quality of the content. A great example of this is providing subtitles for your video content. The second principle, consider situation, advises us to make sure our interfaces deliver a valuable experience for people regardless of what their circumstances may be. For example, making sure that your content is legible on both a mobile form factor and when it's bright outside. The third principle is to be consistent, which helps to ensure that people can understand how to use your product or service without having to learn a completely new way of interaction. While there is a time and a place for experimentation, relying on navigation cues established by the rest of the web helps guarantee that purpose is obvious and operation is quickly understood. Things like templates, design systems, and content style guides all help to make your content feel like one unified whole and not something built out of many disparate and contradictory parts. The fourth principle is to give control. It stipulates that people should be able to access and interact with content in their preferred way. This might seem a little scary at first, but it's important to remember that if someone can't access your content in a way that works for them, they won't engage with it at all. If I'm prevented from making text large enough to the point that I can read it, I won't be able to read it. And if I can't read it, I won't know why the product or service exists or how to use it. Giving control doesn't mean your brand suffers either. Things like the quality of your copywriting, the ease of navigation, your overall color palette, and the quality of your customer support all help to communicate value. The fifth principle is to offer choice, which allows people to have different ways to complete tasks, especially tasks that are complicated or atypical. An example of this could be with deleting an email. You can swipe to delete it, tap a delete button, or select one or more emails and delete them all with a bulk action. Another common example is allowing people to toggle between thumbnail and list views for large amounts of image content, or providing source data tables along with your charts or graphs. The sixth principle, prioritize content, helps people focus on core tasks, features, and information. To do this, you emphasize the main point of the page or view, which helps people to understand the overall purpose of what something is intended to do. Examples of this are a large compose button for an email client, or having the first paragraph of your main content set up expectations about what will be subsequently discussed. The seventh and final principle is to add value, and that's something I think we can all get behind. In the context of inclusive design, adding value means considering the value of features with regards to how they improve the experience for different kinds of people. An example of this is a show password toggle, which helps people verify that the text they entered is correct before submitting. This translates to less people getting locked out because they entered the wrong password, which means that less weak password use, fewer support calls, and less frustration at a very high friction, high value moment, the act of signing up or logging in. So again, what is accessibility? In many ways, it is a framework to help guarantee quality. In being mindful of accessibility's technical, legal, and social concerns, we're able to construct flexible, fault-tolerant, and accommodating experiences to meet people where they are and help them to get what they need when they need it. Adhering to these standards means that there's less overhead created by things like liability and technical debt, and a core of accessible code means that there's things like developer maintenance and onboarding concerns becoming faster and more efficient. And here's some advice that I'll give away for free. A great way to get started checking for and fixing accessibility issues is to install a code auditing tool such as Axe, Arc, Tenon, or Wave. These tools can automatically point out where issues are, why they are issues, and what can be done to fix them. And better yet, they sit in your developer web inspector panel to meet you where you already are. How cool is that? If what I've said sounds interesting, there's also some resources you can check to learn more. The A11Y project is an open source, community-driven effort to make web accessibility easier. It contains linked resources, checklists, tests, how-tos, and even common myths about digital accessibility. Another site is the Inclusive Design Principles, the list I used for this talk. It has even more examples for each principle, and all of them are collected in a way that can be easily shared with other members of your team. Another favorite resource of mine is the Do's and Don'ts on Designing for Accessibility, which is a set of posters put out by the United Kingdom's Government Digital Services team. Each poster includes considerations for designing for different disability types, such as low vision or dyslexia. Hopefully, you now have a better understanding of what digital accessibility is and how important it is for your organization. If you are interested in exploring how to best go about taking what I've discussed today and putting it into practice, I'd love a chance to chat. You can reach us from our website, thoughtbot.com, or via our phone number, 877-9-ROBOTS, or via Twitter or GitHub. Thank you for taking this time to tune in, and I hope we get a chance to chat soon.